Hollywood set they're filming the video for Scream, the first new music from Michael Jackson in 4 years. And as always, there's a kind of distant thunder before the album hits. Especially this time, the album is critical to Jackson and his career. How well will the music roll past the allegations about his private life? Will he prove once again that he is still a musical force to be reckoned with, as he's been for 25 years? In 1968, Michael Jackson and his four older brothers, powered by their father's ambition, are playing in Gary, Indiana, but dreaming of Detroit. And Berry Gordy, the founder of Motown Records, the hitmaker behind the great Solax of the 60s. Berry's assistant, Suzanne DePass, sees the band perform.
My gosh. That's pretty special. Because this little tiny boy was singing with all the soul and passion of a 35-year-old man. And I called Berry Gordy and I said, Mr. Gordy, I have seen something that is just great. He said, really, what is it? I said, it's an act. It's a fabulous singing group. He said, great. I said, they range in age from like 8 to 15. He said, kids?
So when she mentioned about another kids group, I just said, hey, I'm not really interested in another kids group, not at this time.
I persisted, and he said, well, gosh, if you feel that strongly about it, I'll take a look. And he did.
They came to Motown. This is a film of the audition.
First saw them, there was no question that I was interested, not only interested, but I loved them all. You know, I mean, it's incredible. I mean, it didn't take a genius to realize that they had, you know, the talent, and Michael was extremely special.
Gordy assigned Suzanne DePass to groom the boys, pick their clothes, choreograph their dance steps, and make them rehearse and rehearse. While Gordy started looking for the song, the big hit.
And I thought about Michael and this little kid, and I wanted a song that would fit a 9-year-old kid, you know? And so I walked around singing a melody that just came into my head while thinking about this phenomenal kid. Oh, baby, no, I would say, oh, baby, da-da-dee-da-dee, da-da-da-da. That's all I had.
Oh, baby, give me one more chance.
Tell you that I love you.
Won't you please let me back to your heart? Oh, darling, I was blind to let you go.
Let you go, baby.
But now since I see you, it is all.
That was the first release, and that went straight to number one. It was just a major smash.
Probably in fourth grade, and I just remember walking home from school and just hearing that song coming out of car radios and we had little transistor radios. I mean, it wasn't like Walkmans or boom boxes or anything. Little tiny transistor radios, AM radio. And I just remember that song just, it was the bomb. It was the bomb song.
Quick succession, three more number one hits exploded on the airwaves.
It absolutely went from complete anonymity to total celebrity in one beat. The first time we got off the plane in Philadelphia for their first concert, they got mobbed, and it never changed. That was pretty profound for those days, because there had not yet been, I don't think, a young black group that had created what was tantamount to Beatlemania.
A black group shattering mainstream barriers, and a little boy, the obsessive force driving it all. Don't you know
sit around? His brothers might be outside, you know, playing basketball, but he'd be watching the producers mix the record or asking Berry Gordy 1,001 questions about producing and about the business and about why this, why that.
And then I realized that he was studying me. Later I realized, of course, he's not only studied me, but he studied everybody. From Walt Disney, Marcel Marceau, James Brown, Jackie Wilson, you know, all these people he was really studying.
We used to call him the human sponge.
It was inevitable. After 4 years of hits together, traveling together, performing together, Michael Jackson would shoot ahead of his brothers like a meteor.
When we first started, it was all for one for all. And I think as the press and the fans recognized Michael more and more, and it became a disproportionate kind of worship for him, you know, and interest in him, and obsession with the little one, that it drove a wedge between and among his brothers and himself and his brothers' relationships to one another.
By the early 1980s, the Jackson Five began to fade. Michael's solo career took off. Don't Stop Till You Get Enough was the first single from the album Off the Wall, produced by legendary composer and arranger Quincy Jones.
When I first did the album, there were a lot of people, even at his own record company, that were saying he was making a big mistake, you know, which I love. Love to be underestimated. And I think Michael thinks the same way.
Sold 7 million copies. The blockbuster era had begun. Thriller would be the biggest selling album of all time and confirm the music video as a potent form of art and commerce.
Thriller was a phenomenon. I have a theory that you can't create a phenomenon. You can plan to do some television appearances, you can plan to do some videos. What you can't plan is the impact that each of those things are going to have. You can just do them the best you can. You do your album, let's say, now you put out the Billie Jean video. But it becomes more than a video, it becomes the video that breaks black music on MTV, because MTV wouldn't play a black video until Billie Jean. You can't create that. That's just the circumstances that happen. You can't create the Motown 25.
50 million people watched a man whose every muscle moved in choreographed precision, not knowing it almost didn't happen.
Michael basically didn't want to do Motown 25, and I figured if it was ever going to happen, Barry would have to get in there and help.
One of the things I told him was that he thinks he's big now. I said, you are very big now. You think you're really big, but if you do Motown 25, you will go into orbit. That was the first show that he did the moonwalk on. And indeed, he went into orbit. I mean, he went into orbit and never came down.
Thriller sold 47 million records. And for an obsessive performer, a perfect trap. How to keep up the singular brand of mystery? How to top himself. In 1987, the album Bad. In 1991, Dangerous. Millions more records sold. Whole industries were riding on him. Sony signed him to a $65 million contract. And then, 2 years ago, the charges. On tour, Michael Jackson collapsed. Everybody wondered if he could come back, except the people around him who say it's still Michael Jackson.
His hunger for what he does is like, you know, you would expect somebody who's fighting and scrapping to even get in the music business to try to make their first record. That's the kind of hunger and desire he still has. You know, 25 years after I Want You Back, he still has that same desire. That's pretty scary.
Brought together for the new album History, writers and producers like the team of Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. Singers like the group Boys to Men.
This is the guy that we all looked up to. We couldn't help but to look up to him.
And still do.
And still do, you know, in a lot of ways. We never imagined that we'd even meet him. And to have him even ask us to be on, you know, his album, you know, it's a true honor.
In a sense, Michael Jackson has gone back to his roots, working with a member of his family. It's his younger sister, Janet, today a big star in her own right.
I think that this album is very, very important because it's like a crossroads. And he's defining it as a crossroads of his career by making it a greatest hits album. It's like he's acknowledging that this part of my career was great up till now, but I'm gonna move forward.
Decades, the music, the dance, the king of pop, the billion-dollar entertainer. And then, at the height of his success, came the charges, the police investigation, and a superstar, shaken, goes into hiding. Tonight, Michael Jackson. The interview we've been waiting for, live. And for the first time, the woman he married, Lisa Marie Presley, two legendary families united. Home videos of the wedding that startled the world. Lisa Marie Presley, Michael Jackson, Center Stage, and On the Record.
Good evening and welcome to Primetime. Make no mistake about it, for all that fantasy and flash, Michael Jackson is serious business. Ask anyone in this town. Ask the people at Sony Music who say his next album and videos alone could bring in close to $1 billion worldwide. So it's not hard to understand why the shockwave of those allegations 2 years ago registered like the last earthquake out here. Why everyone wants to know, is he really on his way back? This is the old MGM set at Sony Pictures where all those dreams were put on film. It seemed like a good place to begin this hour because whatever you think about Michael Jackson, you cannot ignore what he achieved. A little boy with all those dreams in his voice. I treat you bad. It's the once upon a time story that we all know by heart. Out of this tiny house in Gary, Indiana, from among the 9 children of a crane worker at the steel yards, came the raw talent that rocked Motown. This is the audition in which Michael Jackson charms, glides, and spins his family into stardom. But we've also heard the other side of this fairy tale. The brothers claim that their father drove them brutally, beat them. This is the man Michael said made him nauseous with fear.
I didn't know anything about him being sick, but regurgitating. But if he did regurgitate, he regurgitated all the way to the bank.
But on stage, the little boy felt invulnerable, wielding the voice that would enchant for the next 25 years. Oh, baby, give me one chance. Even as the singer radically changed. We sat down a week and a half ago to talk only about music. We looked at the Ed Sullivan Show, 1970. He remembers exactly what he was thinking.
That the whole world was like watching. My father used to always say, don't mess up, you know? And I felt I knew all every part. And if something went wrong, I felt I could cover it.
But by adolescence, a private price was being paid. He said it was agony when people stared, clearly wishing that he was still that cute little boy. At the time, his mother worried that he was withdrawing.
Michael is quiet now. When he was younger, he wasn't that quiet. But I don't know, I think the stage might have done that to him.
Being around, you know, everyday people and stuff, I feel strange, I do.
Shy?
Yeah.
1979, 2020. He told Sylvia Chase people won't let him be just normal.
They won't talk to me like they will the next door neighbor.
But somehow Jackson used isolation to sharpen his sense of what was exotic and new. By 1983, the 25th anniversary of Motown, another Michael Jackson emerged, his own creation. From the music to the muscle and the magic. It was a triumph, but he still sees only what he missed.
I wanted to do the 5 spins, then go on the toes and freeze there and just hold it and stay there, you know, and I didn't, but they didn't know.
It's the devil's bargain, a perfectionist trying to give the audience more, a chameleon whose changes are more and more extreme. Making you wonder if it's all still part of his plan or, like Faust, his prison. As even today, Jackson obsesses over every word, every move, every sound. Listen.
Hit it.
What you're hearing is not an electric drum machine. It's a hardwired, 48-track, digitally mastered human.
What I mean, so I'll take that and use that as the main foundation for the track and build all the sounds around that. You know what I'm saying?
So whatever the future, the music will always be inside the man who says soon he'll be back where he's most at home.
Are you really anxious to get back on stage?
I miss the fans.
Yeah.
I
that's my chance to get to really, you know, see them and feel their presence.
They follow each other on the wind, you know, cause they got nowhere to go. That's why no one gets to know.
When you do a concert and there's like 100,000 people out there, and you see a sea of people singing with it, all in unison and holding up candles, and you go, wow. You know, it just really makes your heart happy, and that's what really makes you feel like everything's okay.
But as we said, 2 years ago, that shy man faced some grave accusations that he had molested a young boy. As the headlines raged, a lot of people wondered if what had seemed merely eccentric was in fact something sinister. And the children always around him, were they lured by a seducer? The lingering question was Michael Jackson guilty, or had he been put through 2 years of unequaled injustice and hell? For parents, a warning, it's an adult topic.
This was the allegation. A 12-year-old boy said that over a period of 4 months, while repeatedly sleeping alone in the same bed with Michael Jackson, there was kissing, then fondling, then masturbation. The boy said he had protested, but Jackson had wept, saying it was all right, other boys had done it with him. That was the allegation. But for the prosecution, there were problems. The boy had spoken at the urging of his father, who was also seeking custody. And the father had talked to the Jackson camp about money, $20 million, according to the Jackson team. This is that father talking to someone he knew on tape.
If I go through with this, I win big time. There's no way that I lose.
But whatever the circumstances of the disclosure, authorities say they believed the boy's story. The investigation of Michael Jackson was set in motion and within days hit the airwaves.
Tonight, a police investigation into allegations that Michael Jackson sexually abused a young boy.
The pop star Michael Jackson under investigation for alleged child abuse.
It was a tabloid feeding frenzy as people who worked for Jackson shopped stories, all claiming titillating knowledge of what they called his special friends. And even when some of Jackson's young friends tried to defend him, they raised other troubling questions. This, an 11-year-old boy, Brett Barnes, talking to a TV interviewer.
When you'd have sleepovers and you'd stay in the same room or the same bed, did that seem unusual to you at all?
No, because I slept on one side of the bed, he slept on the other, and that was that.
After several months of headlines, Jackson, on tour, and then reportedly in treatment for addiction to painkillers, returned to the United States and submitted to a series of police photographs. Sources say to see if they matched his accuser's description of identifying marks on what authorities called his private parts. December 22nd, Jackson went public.
Don't treat me like a criminal, because I am innocent. I have been forced to submit to a dehumanizing and humiliating examination by the Santa Barbara County Sheriff Department and the Los Angeles Police Department earlier this week. They served a search warrant on me, which allowed them to view and photograph my body, including my penis, my buttocks, my lower torso, thighs, and any other area that they wanted.
1 month later, January 25th, 1994, Michael Jackson settled the civil suit filed by his young accuser. How much? Reportedly in the neighborhood of $15 to $20 million. After the settlement, the boy refused to testify in the criminal case, so after 13 months of headlines, the prosecutors said it was over.
We must decline prosecution involving Mr. Jackson.
They had no other children who would come forward in court, and none of the employees who claimed to have seen questionable things had a story that could be confirmed by a child. To this day, a number of investigators remain convinced that glamour and money are so attractive, they can produce loyalty and silence. While Jackson's team insists that it ended because nothing happened in the first place.
When we come back, Michael Jackson and Lisa Marie Presley, their chance to speak.
Have you seen my childhood? I'm searching for the world.
Primetime Live continues from the Sony Pictures Studios in Los Angeles. Once again, Diane Sawyer.
And with me, of course, Michael Jackson and Lisa Marie Presley. Welcome to Primetime.
Thank
Glad
you.
Glad you're
you.
Here.
Thank you.
It occurs to me, looking at the two of you, I have got to start by asking how this marriage took place, how it began. Let me guess that it was not over miniature golf and a hot dog someplace. When did it start? When was the dating?
Well, we first met, she was 7 years old and I was 17. This was in Las Vegas. She used to come and see my show all the time. We had the only family show on the Strip. It's the Jackson Five. And she used to come as a little girl and sit right up front. She came quite often, but she came with a lot of bodyguards.
And had you stayed in touch over all these
years? Sure. And then she'd come backstage. Then I'd, you know, talk and say hi, and then she'd come again. And I thought she was sweet and loving, and I always hoped I'd see her again.
And who first talked about marriage?
We didn't stay in touch.
We didn't stay in touch after that, no.
Go ahead. You want to say what happened?
No, you can say. You have a good memory.
No, you said you were going to say it.
Our first argument here on this hour. Who proposed? I mean, how did marriage actually get discussed?
Well, at first, this is what happened. When she was 18, I used to tell my lawyer, John Branca, do you know Lisa Marie Presley? He'd go, well, I represent her mother. I go, well, can you get in touch with her? Because I think she's really cute. And he'd laugh every time. He goes, I'll do my best. That's what he'd say. Then he'd come back. I said, well, did you find out? He said, no, there's nothing. So I would worry him about this all the time. And the next thing I noticed, there's a picture on a magazine cover where she's married, which really tore me to pieces.
And
it
then,
really did, because I felt that was supposed to be me. I really did.
And what was the countdown to your marriage? Tell me who said the word marriage first.
I did.
He did.
I did.
When? Where?
When,
on
where?
The telephone.
Telephone. Yeah, on the telephone.
He first asked me.
When?
We were dating now for 4 months. 4 months?
I don't remember.
Well, anyway, we were spending a lot of time together. I don't know how I didn't manage to get in the press, because we weren't hiding it. I was in Las Vegas, we were in Neverland.
We
were everywhere. I went to Atlanta, we were in bookstores. We were not hiding it.
And you said yes right away?
I was separated for 4 months, and he said, what would you do if I asked you to marry me? And I said, I would.
I would, though. You were really enthusiastic.
I have to ask you this, because I can only imagine the number of lawyers involved in a prenuptial agreement between these two fortunes. Mm-hmm. Is there one? A careful one?
Well, we've worked out things and we've signed certain things, but of course, that's very confidential.
We agree. We made agreements prior, yes.
As you know, the reaction to this marriage, and I know you feel strongly about it, but the reaction to this marriage has been across the spectrum, everything from astonishment to delight to suspicion, that it was somehow too convenient. Lisa, did you ask Michael about the charges? Did the two of you talk about the impact of the marriage on the allegations?
Absolutely not. I was in touch with him through the whole process of this charges going on. I was talking to him when he disappeared. I was actually supposed to go to San Juan, Puerto Rico when he left and disappeared, and I got a call that he wasn't going to be there, and I was actually part of the whole thing with him, but talking to him on the phone. So
Did you say to him, are they true?
No, I didn't. No, I actually did not.
I want to take a minute here, and I'm going to come back to the marriage.
He went on and on and on about it, so I didn't really have to say, are the allegations true? It was, you know, on the phone, you know.
And over and over.
Just
again.
Constant, yeah.
Well, because I know that you've wanted to express similar sentiments for a long time. I want to ask a few things about the charges, but first I want to establish for the viewers here, there are no ground rules. You have said to me you are not afraid of any questions. So I wanted that understood by everybody before we proceed. I think I want to begin by making sure that the terms are
clear. You have said that you would never harm a child. I want to be specific as I can. Did you ever, as this young boy said you did you ever sexually engage, fondle, have sexual contact with this child or any other child?
Never, ever. I could never harm a child or anyone. It's not in my heart. It's not who I am. And it's not what I'm I'm not even interested in that.
And what do you think should be done to someone who does that?
To someone who does that, what I think it should be done? Gee, I think they need help in some kind of way, you know?
How about the police photographs, though? How was there enough information from this boy about those kinds of things?
The police photographs.
To have police
photographs. That they took of me.
Yes.
There was nothing that matched me to those charges.
There was nothing. There was nothing that concurred.
That's
nothing.
Why I'm sitting here talking to you today. There was not one iota of information that was found that could connect me to these charges.
So when we've heard that there was a marking of some kind.
No markings.
No markings.
No.
Why did you
Why am I still here then?
You're not going to ask me about that, are you? Sorry, about the markings.
You can volunteer.
No, I'm just... The point is that when that finally got concluded, that there was no matchup, then it was printed this big, as opposed to how big it was, what the matchup was supposed to be.
It didn't work.
It never
isn't so. The whole thing is a lie.
Why did you settle the case, then? Why did you settle the case? And it looks to everyone as if you paid a huge amount of money.
Well, that's, most of that's
to get
folklore.
Silence.
I talked to my lawyers, and I said, can you guarantee me that justice will prevail? And they said, Michael, we cannot guarantee you that a judge or a jury will do anything. And with that, I was like catatonic. I was outraged.
How much money
was it? Totally outraged. So what I said, I have got to do something to get out from under this nightmare. All these lies and all these people coming forward to get paid and these tabloid shows, just lies, 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 lies. So what I did, we got together again with my advisors and they advised me, it was hands down a unanimous decision, resolve the case. This could be something that could go on for 7 years.
How much money
was it? Let's get it behind us.
Can you say how much?
It's not what the tabloids have printed. It's not all this crazy outlandish money. No, it's not at all. I mean, the terms of the agreement are very confidential.
I want to ask. He's been barred to discuss it.
The specific terms.
The idea is just isn't fair. What they put me through, because there wasn't one piece of information that says I did that. And anyway, they turned my room upside down, went through all my books, all my videotapes, all my private things, and they found nothing, nothing, nothing that can say Michael Jackson did this. Nothing.
But let me ask you a couple
of questions. To this day, nothing. Still, nothing.
Let me ask you a couple.
Nothing, nothing, nothing.
Nothing. I got nothing. As you may or may not know, we have called everyone we can call. We have checked everything we can check. We have gone and tried to see if what we heard before is in fact the case. I want to ask you about two things. These reports that we read over and over again, that in your rooms they found photographs of young boys, not of adults.
Young boys, of children, all kind of girls and everything.
And that they found photographs, books, of young boys who were undressed.
No.
Didn't happen.
No, not that I know of, unless people sent me things that I haven't opened. People know my love for children, so they send me books from all over the world, from South America, from Germany, from Italy, from Sweden.
So if people say that they found those things, if there's an indication, let them come forward, let them produce them, right?
Yeah, because you wouldn't believe the amounts of mail that I get. And if you say to somebody, you know, if I let the fans know I love Charlie Chaplin, I'll be swarmed in Charlie Chaplin paraphernalia.
But if
I say I love children, which I do, they swarm me with everything pertaining to kids.
Any other settlements in process now or previously with children making these kinds of claims? We have heard that there is one. Not a case that the prosecutors would bring in court, but that once again you're talking about shelling out.
No, that's not true. No. No, it's not true. I think I've heard everything is fine and there are no others.
I guess, let me ask this, and I'm trying to think how to phrase it, though. I can hear out in the country people saying, and you've been cleared of all the charges, we want to make that clear, people saying, look, here is a man who is surrounded by things that children love. Here is a man who spent an inordinate amount of time with these young boys.
That's right.
What is a 36-year-old man doing sleeping with a 12-year-old boy, or a series of them?
Right. Okay, when you say boys, it's not just boys, and I've never invited just boys to come in my room. Come on, that's ridiculous. And that's a ridiculous question. But since people want to hear it, you know, the answer, I'll be happy to answer it. I have never invited anyone into my bed, ever. Children love me. I love them. They follow me. They want to be with me. But anybody can come in my bed. A child can come in my bed if they want.
I can say, sorry, I've seen this. I've seen it a lot. I've seen kids. I've seen him with children in the last year. I've seen it enough to where I can see how that can happen. It's, you know, I understand.
But isn't part of being an adult, and you have a two-year-old child, two-year-old boy.
Yeah, let me just, sorry.
Okay.
I just wanted to say that I've seen these children. They don't let him go to the bathroom without running in there with them, and they won't let him out of their sight. So when he jumps in the bed, I'm even out. You know, they jump in the bed with him.
But isn't part of being an adult and loving children, keeping children from ambiguous situations? And again, we're talking about over an intense period of time here. Would you let your son, when he grows up and is 12 years old, do that?
You know what, if I didn't know who Michael, no way. But I happen to know who he is and what he is. And that makes it, you know, I know that he's not, you know, I know that he's not like that, and I know he has a thing for children. And I, go ahead, sorry.
I just wonder, is it over? You're gonna make sure it doesn't happen again. I think this is really the key thing people wanna know, that there are not gonna be more of these sleepovers in which people have to wonder.
Nobody wonders when kids sleep over at my house.
But
nobody
are they
wonders.
Over? Are you gonna watch out for it? Now,
watch out for
just
what?
For the sake of the children and for
no,
everything
it's
you've
all,
been through.
It's all moral and it's all pure. I don't even think that way. It's not what's in my heart.
So you'll do
never,
it again?
I would never, ever. Do it, what again?
I mean, you'll have a child
sleeping
over. Of
course.
Over.
They want.
Yes.
It's on the level of purity and love and just innocence, complete innocence. If you're talking about sex, and that's a nut. That's not me. Go to the guy down the street because it's not Michael Jackson. It's not what I'm interested in.
Okay, we're going to take a break now. When we come back, Elizabeth Taylor talked to us a little bit about what she saw when she went over and talked to you in the middle of this and helped you get treatment for addiction to painkillers.
Elizabeth is on the show.
When we come back.
Live from the Sony Pictures Studios in Los Angeles. Once again, Diane Sawyer.
As we said, Elizabeth Taylor is going to talk a little bit about when she came to see you in the middle of this, what she called agony. One of the things she was so angry about with us was that she said people always talk about one side of a person, they never give them credit for their accomplishments.
That's right.
Particularly what they give to children and the money you give to children. That's how it starts.
When he's on tour, he goes to hospitals without the press following him, without anyone knowing. He'll get up in a disguise and do it, take his disguise off when he's there, and kids know, wow, it's Michael Jackson.
Was there no point at which you said to yourself, reading everything everybody had been reading, maybe this is true, maybe I completely didn't understand who he was?
No way. Absolutely not.
Never.
Never. I know Michael's heart. I know his mind and his soul. I'm not that insensitive, especially to him or people I love.
How did you decide to go to Singapore?
He was my friend. He was alone. He was totally alone. And he just, he needed help. Nothing in the world could have hurt him more. If it had been calculated, if they'd planned an assassination, they couldn't have done it any better. It almost broke his heart.
She says she recognized a friend turning to painkillers for escape.
He wasn't aware of what was happening. He was dulling his pain. But it really frightened me because I have been there. And I know how easy it is to get there when you're in mental or physical pain.
And he knew right away that he had to deal with it too?
Not right away. Not right away, but he knew.
There were some reports during this period, Michael, that it was such agony for you that you were actually suicidal. Is that true?
I was never suicidal. I love life too much to ever be suicidal. I'm resilient. I have rhinoceros skin. Never, ever suicidal.
Did it leave you, though?
Heartbroken, but not suicidal.
Did it leave you changed completely? I've talked to you a little bit about what you're thinking about, where you want to live in the world. Did it change your view about living here? You're thinking about living someplace else?
I don't care to stay in America anymore, no. I don't care. I will always have Neverland, you know, because I love Neverland. But I don't like, I'm very sensitive to the smog, you know, so I can't have the smog. And I would like to go abroad. Matter of fact, I am.
You are? Where?
Yes. Oh, I haven't decided the exact place yet. Probably South Africa.
To maybe. Live permanently.
Maybe Switzerland.
Lisa, are
Can
you
we just
in
change...
favor of it?
Wait, just go into the fact that we don't live in separate houses for to start
yeah,
this
Yeah, we don't live in separate... This is just
This
me
is ridiculous,
dreaming.
Wherever the cameras. Anyway, sorry.
No, jump in.
What do I feel about the overseas thing? I think that it's a nice place to visit, yes. I would like to have a house over there. Mm. Would be completely and utterly harassed beyond belief, but...
Before we move away from the last 2 years, we told you, because we want to, that we are going to show what is really your comment on those 2 years, and it is a video you have done with your sister Janet called Scream. And in it, you have some words for middle-aged people who can't follow these words. The words you'll hear will be about confusion, bashing, victimizing. Stop pressuring me, he says. Makes me want to scream, the last 2 years.
Live from the Sony Pictures Studios in Los Angeles, California. Once again, Diane Sawyer.
We have some wedding video of the two of you, and I'm going to let you tell us a little bit about what we're seeing here. If our director, Roger Goodman, wants to roll it in, we will take you there a year ago, right?
Yes.
Just about exactly.
I look like an idiot, I can tell you that.
You don't look like an idiot. You look more like a, no.
Do you want me to tell you?
Yes.
You're watching it.
Tell us.
Oh, we're watching.
Tell us, we're watching here live.
Send up step for the heating of sponsors, and you're Michael Joseph Jackson.
Lisa Marie, resting here. Do you accept Michael Jackson?
Michael Joseph Jackson.
I do.
Michael Joseph Jackson.
I do. In the middle, he asks for his autograph.
Yo, licenciado Hugo Francisco Álvarez Pérez.
Oficial and also more. Yeah, I did.
I didn't fight, but now we're out of time.
Los declaros unidos y legítimo matrimonio.
Okay, if you have the ring.
Congratulations.
Congratulations, and then we're going to do the ring.
Thanks. Sorry. You do it?
Yes.
He do it.
How do I know?
He does first. You put it to her first, okay? And when you put it, you say, with this ring, I do it.
This ring, I do it.
Right. And you do it the same thing. When you put his ring, as you say, with this ring, I do that.
Right now?
So, I know that you, Lisa Marie, have wanted to talk about this. There are a lot of doubters about this marriage. I've heard that it's a Scientology plan. You are a member of the Church of Scientology, which is said to influence its members greatly, and that the husband you divorced was Scientologist, and he's still very much in your life, and this is all part of a calculation to get Michael and his money into the church.
Mm-hmm. Gee. It's crap. I'm sorry. It's like ridiculous. It's ridiculous. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. I'm not, first of all, you can't get influenced by anything like that, and under a term of a marriage, I'm not going to marry somebody for any reason other than the fact that I fall in love with them. Period. Period. And they can eat it if they want to think anything different.
To put it succinctly.
Yeah.
What is it you love the most about him?
Oh, what do I love the most about him? Everything. He's amazing. I really admire him. I respect him. I admire him. I'm in love with him. And no, we don't sleep in separate bedrooms. Thank you very much. And I love everything about him.
To finish up on that, though, are you a Scientologist?
No.
No. Plan to become one?
I believe in spirituality, and I believe in a higher source, such as God, but I'm not a Scientologist. I read everything, and I like to read. I love to study.
You said you don't sleep in separate bedrooms, and I'm going to confess, okay, this is live TV, and I'm copping out right here because I didn't spend my life as a serious journalist to ask these kinds of questions. But I'm not oblivious to the fact that your fans had one question they most wanted to ask of you.
Do we have sex?
We have, you.
She didn't ask.
I won't ask. Okay.
You don't know what it was going to be.
Is that what you were going to ask?
Let's play just a minute or two. Let's play one or two.
We want to know if you've done the thing.
Michael, I know that this is an intimate question, but are you having sex together with Lisa Marie?
Do you guys really love each other, or you're just doing this to satisfy the media?
Are you guys intimate?
Again.
I can't believe it.
But this is about the skepticism.
Yes. Yes.
And we have read in the papers that you are expecting a child.
We will be expecting a child. No, when, I'm not going to.
We're not going to say when.
It's personal.
It's in the hands of the heavens.
But not yet.
Did we marry out of convenience? That's really interesting.
That's really interesting to me.
Why?
Well, why wouldn't we have a lot in common? That's the question. Why? Why not?
Like we're faking this?
Like, no. But you can't live with somebody day to day. We're together all the time, first of all. Second thing, how can you fake that 24 hours a day with somebody, sleeping with somebody, waking up with somebody, having
to...
He's running around the house, I'm running around the house, you were in our house, we have a normal house, we have a nanny, we have a maid, and we walk around, and he's either in the studio, I'm in the kitchen, we're running around like normal, I know it's hard to believe people.
You go shopping together, you...
We go shopping, we go out to dinner, we argue sometimes.
And...
About what, may I say?
We also heard a report that maybe you were planning to adopt the children.
Oh, I would love to adopt children. I think that's something I've always wanted to do. But children of all races, Arab children, Jewish children, black children, it's all races.
But Lisa's children?
I love Lisa's children, but it's been a mission.
But not going to adopt? Or
pardon?
To adopt them, though.
Oh, I love her children. They're sweet.
But to adopt, no.
Of course.
They have a biological father, and he's their...
I think they love me very much. I love them.
They do.
We have a lot of fun.
But I've never heard of that before, personally, of someone adopting someone's children while they're in a relationship with that person.
We're going to take a break for a minute and come back with more questions.
Okay.
I want to say...
Michael Jackson, Lisa Marie Presley, live from the Sony Pictures Studios in Los Angeles. Once again, Diane Sawyer.
We're going to show you a film now created by Michael Jackson, and it is causing a furor in some movie theaters around this country. They say, among other things, that it is clearly modeled after Triumph of the Will, Leni Riefenstahl. A Nazi film with Nazi imagery.
It's not true. None of that's true. None of those things are true.
Did you watch that film before you did it?
I watch everything. I love movies. I love documentaries. Had nothing to do with that at all.
But there are people who keep saying, this is... They look at it and say, this is...
Absolutely not.
You know what?
It's nothing to do with politics or communism or fascism.
Well...
At all.
The critics have said that it's the most boldly vainglorious self-deification a pop singer ever undertook with a straight face.
Good. That's what I wanted.
For the controversy?
Yeah. And they fell into my trap.
For the people who say that...
I wanted everybody's attention.
But for the people who say those symbols matter,
no,
they're about suffering.
No, the symbol has nothing to do with that. It's not political. It's not fascist. It's not dogma. It's not, you know, ideology and all of this stuff. It's pure, simple love. You don't see any tanks. You don't see any cannons. It's about love. It's people coming together.
About love. We're going to let everybody watch a bit.
Yeah, but it's art. It's art.
Okay.
The way a director would use
a
medium to create art.
Here it comes.
Thank you.
As we said, we're going to clearly agree to disagree maybe on what this means to some people watching it. There's been another issue raised. In a song you say, Jew me, sue me, and some people are saying that that is anti-Semitic.
It's not anti-Semitic because I'm not a racist person. I could never be a racist. I love all races of people, from Arabs to Jewish people, like I said before, to blacks. But when I say Jew me, sue me, everybody do me, kick me, kike me, don't you black or white me, I'm talking about myself as the victim. You know, my accountants and lawyers are Jewish. My three best friends are Jewish. David Geffen, Jeffrey Katzenberg, Steven Spielberg, Mike Milken, these are friends of mine. They're all Jewish. How does that make sense? I was raised in a Jewish community.
I want to ask you both about something, because it was the second most asked question by people on the street. And I know it's a sensitive issue for you, and you talked with Oprah about it. But somehow people still are not, they don't feel they've heard everything about the whiteness of your skin, and that it's not somehow a choice on your part, along with the makeup, to be, is it to be neither black or white, neither to look completely male, to be in the androgynous zone? I think they want to know, it is a decision on your part some way, the way you look. Where does it come from?
I think it creates itself, nature.
He's an artist. He
I'm
has
an artist.
Every right.
I'm a
and he is constantly remodifying something or changing it or reconstructing it or, you know, working on some imperfection that he thinks needs to be worked on. If he sees something he doesn't like, he changes it. Period. He re-sculpted himself. He's an artist.
I might want to put a red dot right there one day.
But
or two eyes right here.
Do you wish you were the color you were again?
Do I wish I was the
that color?
That's nature that. I love
but
black.
I love Do you wish black. You were that way?
I envy her because she can tan and I can't.
One more question I want to make sure I ask. Are you going to sing together?
No.
I would love to sing with you.
Mm-mm.
Would you like to sing with me?
You don't sing?
I don't sing. I did sing, but that's not why I married Michael. I don't need that. That's ridiculous. If I wanted it, I mean, I'm not going to marry someone for a recording career, just to clear that up as well.
What?
Stop.
I'm going to let the two of you duke this out over here. We'll take a break and
Stop.
Primetime, live from Los Angeles.
And as our hour ends, I'd like to just ask each of you for a one-sentence answer. Time's so short. Where do you want to be in 5 years?
Oh, boy. I love what I'm doing now and to do everything I can to help the children. And hello, Bobby Sherritt.
I just want people to know what they're dealing with before and understand that I'm not the, you know, that we are not. The jokes, the degrading comments, all that kind of stuff, it's really irritating. So I didn't get to get into that. This is over already, but stuff.
We want to choke them.
All right,
yeah,
so 5 years.
Don't believe the garbage, all the tabloid junk. Don't read it, don't listen to it. It's garbage, it's junk. It's stupid.
And
enough
so,
of it.
And tonight is over. Look at that.
He's a nut. He's a
we
nut.
Will, we'll probably have some final thoughts on all this ourselves next week. Until then, I'm Diane Sawyer, and I hope you join Sam Donaldson and me next week for another edition of Primetime Live.
Have you seen my childhood? I'm searching for the world that I come from. 'Cause I've been looking around and lost and found.